Good morning and welcome to NM Connect, a behind-the-scenes look at Northwestern Medicine's leading edge. We're glad you're here with us this morning, and we're here to talk about aging this morning. And you know what they say about aging, you can't live without it. All right, now I promise that will be the last of my attempts at humor this morning, because we have a serious topic. I think everyone has, no matter what age they are, some great questions about aging. Questions like, what exactly can I expect with aging and what causes it? What can I do now so that I can age gracefully later? And what can I do to help my partner age gracefully? And even though I did this morning, is it true that we shouldn't be using Q-tips? Well, if you have these questions and many other questions, you've come to the right place today, because we're joined by physicians and leaders from across Northwestern Medicine to dig deep into the topic of aging, the science behind it, practical tips that you can start implementing today, and an inside look at how aging can affect men's health. Now, ladies, don't worry. We're not just going to talk about men's health, and we realize that 70% of healthcare decisions are made by women. And so we'll be dedicating a future episode of NM Connect to women's health. But if you have questions today that are specific to aging in women, you can submit them via the Q&A chat box on the side of the screen. So my name is Chris Hensley, and I'm a vice president of philanthropy with Northwestern Memorial Foundation. And I'll be your MC and guide for the next hour. We're thrilled that you've joined us for this inaugural episode of NM Connect, a new webcast series from Northwestern Memorial Foundation designed with you and your questions in mind. I hope that you'll continue to tune in month after month to hear from leaders from across Northwestern Medicine addressing topics that matter most to you and to the communities that we serve. As friends of Northwestern Medicine, we want to be sure that this is an opportunity for you to take a peek behind the curtain at the leading edge medicine that happens every day here at Northwestern Medicine. Now it's my distinct pleasure to introduce our panel of esteemed speakers today. Joining us for the webcast this morning is Dr. Douglas Vaughan, Dr. June McKoy, and Dr. Ted Schaeffer. I'd like to welcome our panelists. We're glad that you could be here with us this morning. So we'll be introducing each of you in further detail throughout the webcast today, sharing many of your accolades and accomplishments. But before we do that, I'd like to give the audience a quick chance to get to know you a little bit. So let's do a quick round of introductions. So Dr. Vaughan, welcome.
Good morning. Nice to see you.
Good morning to you. You as well. Tell me what you're most excited to share today with our audience.
That the biology of aging is being revealed, that the curtain is being pulled back, and over the next 2 decades or so, we will see a dramatic transformation in our ability to slow down aging in human beings.
Yeah, I had an opportunity, Dr. Vaughan, to take a peek at your presentation this morning, and I'm really excited to hear about it. Dr. Vaughan, go ahead.
I was just going to make a comment that we had an opportunity to see aging in real time this morning with the technical difficulties that we had before we started. In 7 minutes, you aged about 10 years.
Thank you very much, Dr. Vaughan. We'll laugh about that for a while. I'll remember to unplug my microphone when I stand up.
Yes.
Yeah. We're all humans here this morning. So, Dr. McKoy, good morning, Dr. McKoy. How are you?
Good morning. Thank you.
Great. There are a lot of rumored aging tips out there, and I want to give you the opportunity to dispel one of those rumors here first off the bat.
That as you're aging, your life is ending. That's totally not true. In fact, it's a wonderful time to be aging in the world right now, especially in the United States, and your best days are still ahead of you.
I like it. I think that all the time. The glass is always half full, right?
Absolutely.
All right. Good deal. Okay, last but not least is my friend Dr. Ted Schaeffer. Glad to have you with us this morning, Dr. Schaeffer. How are you?
Doing great. Thanks for having me.
Good, good. So what do you think our audience this morning will be most surprised about during today's webcast?
I think they're going to love Doug's presentation about the science of aging, and I think looking forward to Dr. McKoy and myself giving practical tips for how all of our engaged audience can really make a difference in their everyday, day-to-day life starting today.
Exactly. All right. I'm looking forward to it as well. So we're going to jump right in. So we're going to start with Dr. Douglas Vaughan. We're now joined by Dr. Vaughan. He's the Irving S. Cutter Professor and Chairman of the Department of Medicine at Northwestern University's Feinberg School of Medicine. He's a fellow of the American College of Cardiology. He's been elected to membership roles with the American Society for Clinical Investigation, as well as the Association of American Physicians. Dr. Vaughan, thank you for joining us here this morning. We're very excited to learn more from you about the science behind aging, as well as some of your research initiatives, and perhaps even touch on this rumored fountain of youth. So Dr. Vaughan, please take it away.
Thank you very much, Chris. And I'm delighted to participate in this program this morning as we talk about aging from a variety of different perspectives. Now, maybe you've driven around town and seen this billboard. The first person to be 150 years of age is already alive. Maybe it's Chris. Maybe it's the grandchild of one of our listeners today. But the reality is that the curtain is being pulled back on the biology of aging, and we can expect dramatic changes in the lifespan and the health span of humans in the not too distant future. Just if you're a record keeper, the longest documented lifespan of a human being thus far is 122 years. So 150 would be quite a stretch. But the idea is out there that there are interventions that are likely to be presented to us and available to us in the not too distant future that can change the course of human aging. So why do we think this is true? Well, I think this slide really illustrates a concept that probably everyone in listening to us this morning has thought about, that there are differences in the rate of aging of human beings. It's not how many times you spin around the sun. It's really about the biological age that you express. And so I'm sure you know people in your life, in your family, that you're acquainted with that seem like they never age. I'm sure you know people that seem like they age very rapidly. There are lots of different things that impact upon that process and those progressions. And we'll talk a little bit about that today. I want to make three points about what's going on here at Northwestern right now, that we have deep and diverse interests and activities in the science of aging right now on campus. It's one of the focused areas of development for our entire faculty and for our medical center. The dean has articulated a desire to advance two major projects over the next few years. One is around augmented intelligence or artificial intelligence, and the other is around aging. We already have great strengths on campus with regard to aging. We have a program that looks at superagers led by Marcel Masulam in the Department of Neurology. He looks at people that lived to be greater than 90 that still have great functional capacity, trying to understand what it is that protects them. Is it their genes? Is it their diet? Is it something else? We have a huge program in the aging in the lung led by Scott Buttinger in the Department of Medicine. We also just received an award of a Pepper Center here at Northwestern led by Mike Wolf and Jeff Linder in the Division of General Internal Medicine, one of 13 such centers in the country that really distinguishes us as a place in the country that focuses on aging-related research. So, There's a biology that you can tell around aging, as I've already mentioned. You can come into the hospital with me today and we could walk around on the wards and we could see people that are aging rapidly or slowly. We have patients in the hospital all the time with genetic forms of rapid aging or acquired forms of rapid aging, probably the most common clinical condition that causes rapid aging that we see here every day is end-stage renal disease. In particular, individuals that are on dialysis age very rapidly. So the fact that we know that there are differences in the trajectory of aging allows us to think about, well, how do you measure that? Well, it turns out there are a variety of different things that we can look at because there is a fingerprint of aging. For example, our chromosomes change as we age. The tips of our chromosomes shorten every time our cells divide and our telomeres shorten. And you may be, have heard of that. You may have even had your, the length of your telomeres measured. There are other molecular programs that are activated as we age or as our cells become senescent, and we can measure those quite readily and directly. There are proteins that are generated by cells that have entered an aging paradigm or an aging program, and they include a variety of different factors. We'll focus on one of them today that's highlighted in that oval that just appeared on your screen, plasminogen activator inhibitor type 1, or PI1 for short. It's the gene, it's the protein that my laboratory has worked on for the last 30 years, and we think it's involved in aging, and it's a particularly interesting target if we think about trying to slow aging in human beings. Mm-hmm. And there are also physiological changes that we can measure in human beings, simple things like their hearing, sight, their blood pressure. Now, so we've worked on PI1 for a long time. We found that mice that are deficient in PI1 are protected from a variety of different conditions or forms of aging, whether it's cardiovascular or neurocognitive or pulmonary. But how do we translate those findings in mice into human beings? How would you do that? How would you even think about it? Well, it turns out in northeastern Indiana, not far from Chicago, there's a distinct community of Old Order Amish that originally settled there from Switzerland in the early 1800s. They live in and around Bern, Indiana, and it turns out that they're the only known group in the world that harbors a genetic variant in the gene that codes for PI1. Now, there are 20,000 members of the community today. Probably 2,000 to 3,000 members of the community carry this novel genetic mutation. It turns out that the mutation has been described. It causes the carriers of the mutation to have half the normal PI1 level in their blood. And they can, everybody that carries the mutation can trace their lineage back to a single ancestor that married into the community in the early 1830s. That founder had 15 children and 138 grandchildren. And everyone that carries the mutation now can trace their lineage back to that single individual. If they did 23andMe, they would all trace back to that same individual. So we hypothesized that the carriers of this mutation would be protected from aging in a variety of different ways based on what we learned in experimental models of disease in mice. Well, it turns out they actually are. And we published this work a couple years ago that carriers of this mutation are protected against biological aging in a variety of different ways. Cardiovascular, metabolic, their telomeres are longer, they even live longer than their unaffected kindred. So this is the first group like this that's been described in the world, where a single gene mutation seems to impact upon the trajectory of aging in a human population, and that gives us insights into potentially how we might think about preventing or slowing the aging process in human beings in general. So is there a fountain of youth in northeastern Indiana? Well, maybe. We need to expand our work there. Our plans are to eventually try to genotype every willing member of the community and specifically look at the older members of the community to see how they're protected from aging in a variety of different ways, and also to look at the trajectory of aging in that population. It's a tremendously exciting time. It's a remarkable world that we have, and to have an opportunity like this to be able to test a hypothesis in a natural experiment that's going on right next door to Chicago, and to be able to verify and validate what we've seen in experimental models is really just astonishing to me and motivates me to continue our work and to see if the Amish can't actually teach us, the rest of us in the world, something about healthy aging in the years to come. Thanks for letting me participate in this program this morning.
Fascinating, Dr. Vaughan. So we talked a week or so ago on this topic, and I surmised that maybe you're 130 years old right now, and you've been taking this magical fountain of youth pill for the last 30 years or so.
That's twice you've insulted me now.
Twice, yeah, sorry. I'm sure our audience members have questions. I have one that's come in here already. If you haven't already, please be sure to submit your questions using the Q&A function on the right side of your screen. So the first question, Dr. Vaughan, that we have here is that life expectancy in the U.S. increased 30 years from 1900 to 2000. Will that life expectancy rate continue?
That's hard to know. There are so many factors that contributed to that improvement in life expectancy in the U.S., including public hygiene, antibiotics, vaccinations, etc. I think to move it that much more in the relatively near future, I think will be very challenging.
Right. Okay. All right. Well, we're going to move on now. Dr. Vaughan, thank you so much for sharing that little insight to a potential fountain of youth with us. We certainly appreciate your time with us here this morning. So next, we're going to welcome Dr. June McKoy. Dr. McKoy is an associate professor of medicine, preventive medicine, and medical education. She's an academic geriatrician and an NIH-funded health services researcher at Northwestern University's Feinberg School of Medicine. She is also the Geriatric Medicine Fellowship Program Director at McGaw Medical Center. She's a nationally known expert in the field of aging, and on top of all of that, she's a licensed attorney in the state of Illinois. Dr. McKoy, thank you again for being with us here this morning. We're really excited to talk with you today about some practical tips and tricks that our audience can walk away with and help them live well as they age. Dr. McKoy, take it away.
Thank you, Chris. It's a pleasure to be here and talking to these wonderful people. I've woken up early this morning to hear this presentation on aging. I want to kind of pivot from what Dr. Vaughan talked about and to take a little time to point out that we at Northwestern are doing exciting, truly exciting work in the field of aging. I'm a co-investigator on that Pepper Center grant that Dr. Vaughan talked about. And I need to also add that we recently got a center grant on a P30 grant in the Cancer Center, on which I'm a co-investigator looking at cancer and aging. So Northwestern is on the forefront truly of aging research and aging medicine. Now let's talk about aging from the perspective of what we can do ourselves. Dr. Vaughan talked about genetic underpinnings of aging, and he talked about the research that he's doing, the exciting research. What can you do as you age? Well, in terms of demographics, we know that approximately 800,000 Americans turn 60 each day. That's a lot of Americans getting older. And as someone mentioned earlier about the baby boomers getting coming of age. And so we have those people from who were born in 1946 coming through the 70s who are actually getting older. Older adults are the fastest growing segment of the United States population. In fact, the oldest subsection of this population are those 85 years and older. Fantastic. One in four Americans will be 65 years of age or older by 2060. We're talking 40 years from now. So what can we do? Well, we talked about genetic underpinnings, but let's talk about how we as individuals who are aging can disrupt aging from the inside and from the outside. Dr. Vaughan mentioned some physiologic changes of aging, and those are physiologic refers to basically normal aging changes. They may not be changes that we want, but they happen anyway. What can we do to stave off some of these changes from affecting our quality of life and our overall outcome? Well, Let's cultivate sustainable behavior changes. And what do I mean by that? People need to connect more. People need to change their diet, and we'll talk a little bit more about that later. And people need to make sure that they're keeping active both physically and cognitively. And by cognitively, I'm talking about brain health. Let's solve the brain fitness puzzle in this presentation. At least let's start talking about it and ways in which you can actually make your brain a better brain for you. Cognitive superagers, another term Dr. Vaughan mentioned. It's very, very, very important group of people. We're doing research here at Northwestern that shows that people in their 90s into their 100s are actually doing well cognitively in terms of memory. And although they're aging, they're actually aging extremely well. What do they have that we don't have, those of us who are aging regularly? Well, we know they may have the genes definitely for that. Something came from their parents to themselves. But for those of us who are not very fortunate to have those genes, what can we do? We can take ownership of the aging process, and we can actually become, in a way, super agers. Now, one thing I like to quote is a piece that Martin Luther King Jr. wrote many, many years ago. And when he wrote it, I don't think he was thinking about aging, but we have co-opted that one and we're using it because it really epitomizes what we should be doing as we move towards our older age. And that means if you can't fly, run. If you can't run, walk. And if you can't walk, crawl. By all means, keep moving. Have you seen little babies, no matter what? They're moving all the time. And they're doing well. In a program not long ago, I was asked by Brian Williams on the NBC News, Dr. McKoy, what takeaway point would you leave for an older person who needs to age well or who is trying to age well? I said, I'd tell them to keep moving. Just like a car that sits in your garage and doesn't move will break down. And I had that happen to me recently. I had my Acura sitting in my garage and I wasn't driving it. I was taking the bus. When I tried to move that car, it wouldn't move. We are like these cars. We need to oil or all the little areas that need oiling. We need to get our filters changed. We need to actually get the engine turning over. We need to keep moving. What you can do, the most important thing for me and what I've seen in my research and in taking care of patients is you keep on moving. Exercise actually solves most every problem that an aging individual will experience. What else can you do other than moving? Well, how about your diet? We do know that your diet really actually has a lot to do with how your brain works and how your body functions, how the heart does its work, how the lung processes and makes you do well. What foods should you be eating? Well, some recommendations for you. Eat the things that your grandparents tried to give you. Those green things that you thought were just horrible. Those are what you should be eating. Green leafy vegetables filled with all the nutrients that you need and filled with these things called antioxidants that can help to keep your brain healthy. Eat berries, blackberries, blueberries, strawberries. Throw some in with your cereal in the morning. So throw some in with your oatmeal, but eat those colorful things because they're going to keep your brain healthy and keep your body healthy. I know many of you don't like fish and we're not on the East Coast. We're in the Midwest where most of you are listening to me and you might not be seeing fresh fish all the time, but try your best to eat fatty fish, halibut, codfish, salmon, and sardines. All these fish that are oily are filled and rich in omega-3 fatty acids. And we know that omega-3 fatty acids can be very helpful in keeping your brain free of inflammation, very good actually for your joints. And can keep you optimized and move you towards healthy aging. What else can you do? I'd recommend that you see a geriatrician early when you're getting about 65 or older. And why do I say that? So you can set a planning stage, or what we call plan your lifestyle program, and put that in place. The geriatrician will do something called a comprehensive geriatric evaluation. They'll evaluate your memory. They'll do a physical evaluation. They'll have you walk and see how well you can walk. They'll time your walking to see, make sure that your gait speed is good. And they'll do a social evaluation. Just like many of you are planning your 401k, if you're still working, you're planning your things for your family or passed on. You're planning things for the future. One thing to make sure that you do is plan how you're going to live this extremely long and wonderful life that we believe you will have. So see a geriatrician, ask for a comprehensive geriatric evaluation. And finally, what else can you do? Stay socially connected. The brain is like any other organ. It wants to be exercised. If you don't use it, you could lose it. We know the brain has what's called plasticity. Therefore, the brain has the ability to make new connections. I know one of the things people fear the most, and that was actually reported by the New York Times many years ago, is dementia, not having their memories. Don't sit and think because your great-grandmother had problems with her memory that you will necessarily have that. You can turn it around. You can do what I said, disrupt aging from the inside and out. So keep active cognitively. Do Sudoku, crossword puzzles, word jumbles. Get these coloring books and start doing coloramas and stay connected. If you are an introvert, try your best to get out of your shell a bit and make friends. Make friends with people who are a bit younger than you if you have to, so that you have those friends to carry with you into aging. But stay connected socially. Isolation destroys our bodies, both physically and mentally. And stay connected as you walk into this beautiful life that's ahead. Yes, there may be a pill, that so-called pill that will make us live and be youthful forever. But until that pill is discovered, let's try to disrupt aging on our own by following a healthy lifestyle, good diet, exercise, and social connection. Thank you.
All right, Dr. McKoy, thank you so much. You talked about that magic pill there at the end. And we have a question that came in from a member of our audience. And the question is about the pill Prevagen. And they're asking if products like Prevagen actually do anything or if they're just snake oil.
Prevagen might be helpful, and I'll tell you why. It has some of the properties of some of the substances that we have told our patients to take. For instance, vitamin B12, we know it's good for memory and cognition. Thiamine or vitamin B1 is also a part of Prevagen. And Prevagen has other proprietary things in it. If you can afford Prevagen, you can take it because it's not going to harm you. But you actually don't need to spend that money because you can just go to your local pharmacy, make sure that you're on your B12. Of course, after talking with your doctor to see where your levels are, that you're getting enough B1 and that you're actually getting other things from diet like omega-3 fatty acids and so on. If you follow a great diet, you don't need to buy Prevagen, but I wouldn't say it's a snake oil potion. I'm just saying if you're following a great diet and making sure that your vitamin levels are corrected, you don't need to buy that product.
Right, Right, great. Okay, so one other question for you. What tools or technologies do you think have the biggest impact on leading a healthy lifestyle?
If I might deviate a little bit for a bit and mention that to live a healthy lifestyle, you need to stay informed. That's the most important thing. And then, of course, in the context of getting good information, you know, the tools that we have now at our fingertips, like your iPad, your iPhone, a lot of people get their information from that. But using those tools, I think, have made a big difference because they've connected us to a lot of information that's available outside. One thing I want to caution you to do, though, is in using tools like your mobile devices and so on, make sure that any information that's new and a little bit concerning is discussed with your primary care doctor or any other trusted physician or healthcare provider that you see to make sure that the information will not harm, but actually will be augmenting your health and improving your outcome as you age.
All right, Dr. McKoy, a couple quick hit questions that are coming in from our audience here. Does fish oil help if you don't like to eat fish?
Fish oil helps. A lot of people don't like the smell of fish or the taste of fish. Fish oil is good. About 1,000 milligrams of omega-3 fatty acid is quite helpful. Again, discuss the brands with your primary care doctor. Often I tell people to buy a brand that has the USP seal, USP standing for United States Pharmacopeia. And that is because the Food and Drug Administration, or the FDA, does not regulate supplements and so on. And so you cannot be quite sure exactly if you're getting what the product says you're getting. The closest you come to getting the right product is to get a product with the USP seal. And yes, omega-3 fatty acid as a pill form is just fine.
All right, another quick question here. Somebody's asking about their father who got dementia at the age of 90. And he was told by his family doctor that he's old and this is just something that happens. Is that common among family doctors?
Well, you know, I think why the family doctor said that too, it's because you see dementia more so as people age. Primarily Alzheimer's disease will be something of aging. That's why we call it senile dementia. So he's not wrong, but the story doesn't end there. I think when you see that happening, you need to, certainly if you have the opportunity, get that patient, get your father to see a geriatrician. Because many times you can reverse some of this. Some patients' memory problems is because they're low on a vitamin like B12 or vitamin D, which we now know affects memory. And sometimes their memory might be bad because there's something going on within their brain that can actually be addressed. They might have had a stroke and they could be taken to see a speech therapist to get back some of the cognition and the memory that they've lost. So I think the story doesn't end there. Yes, it's common in aging, but to say that as you get older, this is what you should expect, I think it implies that it's totally not correct.
Great, great. Well, thank you very much, Dr. McKoy. So there are a ton of really good questions coming in. We're going to bring our panel back in a little while, and we'll get to some of those questions. I also hope everybody is taking notes at home. But if you're struggling to keep up with all of this great content, I do want to let you know that this webcast will be posted on the Foundation's website, which is foundation.nm.org/nmconnect. After this session is over. So we're going to go to our final speaker this morning here before we bring them all back as a panel for some Q&A at the end, Dr. Ted Schaeffer. Dr. Schaeffer is the chair of the Department of Urology at the Feinberg School of Medicine, and he's program director of the Genitourinary Oncology Program at the Robert H. Lurie Comprehensive Cancer Center of Northwestern University. Dr. Schaeffer, we're glad to have you here with us this morning. As a urologist, you're more male-focused in your practice, but I'm guessing that you get questions related to aging frequently.
It's true. We take care mostly of men in our clinic, but I would say there's 100% engagement in how to live healthier lives and how to enhance one's vitality while the clock. And I think that's a great segue into my presentation today. And so why is it that so many people we see in clinic are interested in living longer, healthier lives? Well, in fact, as was alluded to earlier, the numbers are quite staggering. Over the age of 85, women outnumber men almost 2-to-1. So the gentlemen in our clinic, they're really dialed into this, and you know, with them are also enhanced, are engaged in really trying to equalize these numbers. So I would encourage the audience to get out pens and pieces of paper so we can take some practical notes and give some practical tips today as to how to equalize these numbers. And I broke it down into four general categories, ways to think about enhancing our lives, healthy aging, and augmented vitality. And those include cancer prevention, heart health. These are the two main factors that really affect our longevity, as well as hormonal optimization, as well as overall generalized wellness. Now, let's first talk about hormonal balances and hormonal optimization. So what distinguishes men from women? Well, this we could debate this, Chris, for hours, I think. But there are some biologic differences between men and women, and one is testosterone. This is the principal male hormone. And we know that over time, as we age, our testosterone values decline. And our testosterone values actually play substantial roles in interfacing with other components of our body. So testosterone regulates our overall brain health. It affects our kidney and our blood health, muscle mass, bone health. So the role of testosterone within a man's body is quite significant. There's definitely an interplay between testosterone levels and heart disease, as well as testosterone levels in other endocrinologic disorders like diabetes and thyroid disorders as well. So it plays a key role. And what we know for sure is that there's a lot of debate about what's testosterone number, but I think a clear take-home message for today is that extreme highs of testosterone and extreme lows of testosterone are really life-threatening conditions and probably should be ideally managed. Now, moving to testosterone, let's talk about the leading cause of death within men. And we are, of course, on this call with one of the country's leading cardiologists, Dr. Doug Vaughan. He certainly will attest to these numbers. But heart disease accounts for 1 in 4 male deaths. And men are at increased risk for dying of heart disease compared to women by about 60% or 1.6-fold. Now, these numbers can seem scary, but Dr. Vaughan and his colleagues at our Bloom Cardiovascular Health Institute have really made substantial impacts on deaths from heart disease over the last 30 years. And in fact, those numbers have declined by about 22%. And that's the panel here on the left. Death from heart disease has gone down. And unfortunately, we have a new battleground, and that is cancer. So as individuals, men in particular, live longer, and they are no longer dying of heart disease, we have to think about cancer, and that is at the forefront of our next aging dilemma. So why is that? Cancer affects older men more than any other population in the U.S. and the world for that matter. And the reason that I'm so interested in this is that many of these cancers associated with the aging male are urological. Bladder cancer and kidney cancer go up in men as they get older. Now, on the right, there's a table here. This is a summary of the leading causes of cancer death in men. And this is not, I didn't put this up here to discourage you. I put this up here because I think this is in many ways encouraging. If you look at the leading causes of cancer death, 2 of the top 4 can be prevented or reduced by thoughtful screening. That's prostate cancer and colon and rectal cancer. Thoughtful screening, beginning at an early age and passing through one's entire life, can reduce deaths from those cancers. And lifestyle alterations, smoking cessation in particular, can further reduce deaths from lung cancer and from bladder cancer. So definitely substantial modifications can be made with thoughtful screening and thoughtful smoking. Now, the other thing that's important to talk about, and Dr. McKoy certainly emphasized this as well, is overall wellness and mental health. And the study that I love to quote is this Harvard study of adult development. This particular study is really neat. Again, over 25 years ago. And this study involved enrolling individuals who were 19 years old, who were either starting out at Harvard or actually were just individuals living in the city of Boston. And they asked them questions every single year about how they were doing. And they wanted to understand what kept them healthy and what kept them happy. And the most important factor that drove a happy and healthy life were relationships, relationships between individuals. As Dr. McKoy said, it's important to get out, particularly now in this COVID era. It's important to maintain high quality relationship with individuals. Other things that augmented aging, limited alcohol and tobacco use, limited or no alcohol and tobacco use, physical activity, as Dr. McKoy alluded to. All these strategies together will enable individuals to have healthy coping mechanisms to live longer, more vital lives. So in summary, healthy aging for men is many, many things. I always emphasize to my patients, particularly when I see them at a young age, that it is an ongoing and active process. And what do I think? I think late 30s and early 40s. So it really requires a strategy. Everything that we've talked about today requires thoughtfulness, and it requires really decades of implementation to fully maximize the return on the investment. So let's talk about some nitty-gritty things. Within cancer prevention, thoughtful screening for colon and prostate cancer, smoking cessation to reduce lung and bladder cancers. Within the heart, cholesterol checks, blood pressure control, daily exercise. Hormonally, it's to make sure that you're not developing or pre-diabetic, that you understand your testosterone, your thyroid levels, et cetera. And from a mental health and wellness perspective, relationships are key, and daily exercise, getting out, walking, are key factors that can enable us to live healthier, more vital lives. And with that, I'd like to conclude and certainly open things up for questions.
Yeah, that's great. Dr. Schaeffer, thank you so much. So we have had a couple questions that have come in here about COVID and the ways that people can continue to stay connected during a pandemic like this.
Yeah, I think it's really important. Obviously, there's a lot of technological advances that have occurred that enable us to stay connected. In fact, we're doing one today. You know, in years past, we may have done this in person, but we're utilizing technology to try to be as engaged as possible. I think getting out and meeting folks and walking outside, particularly this time of the year in the Midwest, is certainly an important way to do that. And it can be done, and it is really important as our days shorten to make those interpersonal connections and talk to folks.
Yeah, that's great. Dr. Vaughan, as soon as you finished speaking, a question came in about that Amish community in Northeast Indiana. Somebody wanted to know what the medical diagnosis was that distinguished this group. Was it lower blood pressure? Was it lower cholesterol? Were there other problems that...
The specific genetic mutation was identified because there are a few homozygotes in the population, maybe 10 of them total, and they've got an unusual bleeding disorder. That alerted some astute physicians to look into what could be causing that. And Proband, the original young woman that presented with the bleeding problem, was found to have two copies of the gene variant. And but there are only a few of those individuals. The story that's interesting are the heterozygotes. They have nothing at all on the outside. You would never know that they're carrying this genetic mutation, and most of them don't know it either.
Interesting. Okay. Let's see, we have a question here for Dr. Schaeffer. Dr. Schaeffer, how does the PSA test fit into thoughtful treatment for prostate cancer?
Well, PSA test is a test, and we use it in collaboration with our patients as a opportunity to identify and screen for prostate cancers that may be occurring early on or at early stages. Simple blood test. We use that simple blood test in collaboration with our patients. So we ask our patients discussion, say, hey, is this something that you'd be interested in doing? You may have a family history. You may have longevity in your family. Is this something that would be worth doing for you? And if they agree, we can order the test, and then we can interpret it with them.
Great. Okay. All right. Dr. Schaeffer, we're going to stick with you for a second. If a male is particularly introverted, how can this person begin to make an effort to connect with others?
Well, I think commonalities. So you really want to try to focus on what things that you do get you engaged and get you your brain stimulated, as Dr. McKoy alluded to. And these days with the internet, you can certainly find clubs out there for just about every single hobby you can think of. And so it's an opportunity for you to connect with people of like mind, to think about things in ways that you do. And that's a good way for people who maybe historically were quieter and less interested in being out there can really make connections. There's always someone else like you who's interested in talking to you out there.
Let's see, the ad of Facebook says there's a Facebook group for everybody. There's probably a real group in real life for everybody as well.
Yes.
All right, Dr. McKoy, you talked about the comprehensive geriatric evaluation. One of our viewers here this morning wanted clarification on who that health professional is that they should see.
So they should see a geriatrician, and that would be someone who has had additional training in geriatric medicine after doing their initial residency in internal medicine. So that person would understand all the components of the comprehensive geriatric assessment, and along with the team would help to execute that. So just to add a little bit more of clarity, the comprehensive geriatric evaluation is done by a team, a social worker, the geriatrician or the geriatric fellow, a geriatric trained nurse. And then we sometimes have others to whom we send a person to get additional evaluation. That would be a dietitian and a neuropsychologist. So it's done by a physician who has training in geriatric medicine, has that expertise.
Very good. Very good. Thank you very much. All right. So one more question around COVID. And it's possible, yes, to stay connected through virtual means like this. But how do you replace physical touch? I'm going to throw that question out to everybody. How do you replace physical touch when we're all trying to stay 6 feet apart?
I'll start off. I just came off actually yesterday the inpatient medicine teaching service. It was very hard. And I say that because we naturally want to go close to our patients and to touch them. But you actually can be socially distant and still touching people by using what we call virtual hugs. And we find that it works for us. We will do things like this, and we'll tell nurses we just care about them by doing this, and the nurses do it back to us. We have been doing that in our patients' rooms, and our patients actually love it. They feel that we're, because they know that our vibes, the positive vibes are coming from us, and they see the act of us doing like this. So we're borrowing some of the signs from those who do sign language. And I think it's making an impact. Patients are smiling when I go to the rehab center to see my older adults. They're happy when you do that, and they do it right back to you and smile. So I think you do the best that you can, but showing them that literally that there is an act that you're doing that really doesn't 100% replace the real thing, but it comes close, I think it's a good thing.
Dr. McKoy, while I have you there real quick, what dosage of vitamin B12 do you recommend?
Again, I would ask that people have their levels checked to see where they are, but I normally start people at 1,000 micrograms once a day.
Okay.
And most All right. Americans tend to be deficient.
Right. Okay. So, again, a big thank you to each of our fantastic presenters here today, Dr. Doug Vaughan, Dr. June McKoy, and Dr. Ted Schaeffer. We're grateful for the time that you spent with us here this morning, for sharing your expertise with us, and your willingness to connect with this special group of supporters who joined us today. And to each of you watching from home or from work or possibly from your car, thank you to each of you who took the time to join us today for this webcast. As volunteers, as donors, as friends and community members, you are what truly make Northwestern Medicine better.